Zoom this morning, and also any who are joining us in a recorded service later. Let's pray. Creator God, we confess that we are humans, created in your image, yet often missing the mark. Holy Spirit, blow your wind through us. Show us the corners that need to be cleared to make room for you. Jesus, stay by our sides as we walk with you. Amen. God gives wisdom. From God's mouth comes knowledge and understanding. Proverbs 2:6. God, quiet our spirits in order that we might be present and pay attention to your voice, seeking deeper wisdom. Amen. Our order of worship will be the following. First will be our offering prayer, then worship song, Be Thou My Vision. Jeff Landis will lead us in the pastoral prayer today. Paul Shelley has the children's story. Our text today is James 3, 13 to 18. And Mike Clymer will have our sermon entitled Called to Deep Wisdom. Our response song will be Psalm 19. Announcements, benediction, and our reconnect time. If you are worshiping through Zoom after the benediction, unmute your microphone and turn on your camera. For about 15 minutes following the service, you have an opportunity to enjoy reconnecting with your Jubilee family. Paul Shelley will lead that Zoom connecting time. As we give our offerings, which happen in different ways these days, let's remember to always turn our hearts and minds toward God as we do that. Let's pray. God, make us foolish enough in our generosity that we might become wise enough to know that our gifts will bless others. The hungry, the searching, the lonely, the weak. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. It's good to be with you this morning, Jubilee, and I'm happy to lead this part of our service where hopefully we can come together and remember how significant our prayers are and how, especially as we come together and pray together, how important it is to do that and to lift each other up and others up in that way. Stephen Yoder requests prayer. Stephen's grandpa, Ethan Good, passed away this week. In addition to being Stephen's grandfather, Brother Ethan was a respected builder and a beloved pastor. If you have a prayer request that you would like included in tomorrow's newsletter, please contact Kelsey today. Let's pray together. Lord, we come before you this morning, lifting our hearts to you. We thank you for this beautiful day and your many blessings, the way you reach out and care for us each and every day. Lord, we lift up Ethan Good's family and friends and others who are mourning loss at this time. Lord, we pray your comfort. We pray your presence with them in these times. Lord, we also thank you for your love and care. And we think of those that may not be feeling well today. Lord, we pray your healing to come to them at this time, that you would work your healing power in each of their lives, whatever's going on, whatever needs to be healed today. Lord, I also come to you this morning and thank you for your grace and for your mercy. And I pray, Lord, that you help each one of us to continue to repent and to help us to turn our hearts, turn our eyes towards you this week, Lord, and help us to follow you together. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Children, it is time for our children's story today, and Paul Shelley is bringing that. And before that story, though, we will have our Jesus Loves Me song. So get up, sing along, and dance with that first.
Hey there, Jubilee. Today, Mr. Mike is going to talk about wisdom. Someone who has wisdom is someone who knows a better way of doing something. Did you know that we have a lot of people at Jubilee that have wisdom? For example, if my air conditioner stops working in the middle of summer, I can go to Mr. Marvin and he can help me fix it. Or if I hurt my finger playing basketball, Ms. Fern can tell me what I need to do to make it feel better. Do you know who shared the best wisdom about how we should live our lives? Jesus. That's right. Jesus shared that wisdom with everyone he met. And lucky for us, there were people that heard that wisdom and wrote it down so that we can read about it and apply it to our lives today. We call the wisdom of Jesus the gospel. And as Christians, we try to live by that wisdom and share it with others. But the wisdom that Jesus shared wasn't the same as the wisdom people were used to hearing.
What?
As a matter of fact, most of the time, the gospel of Jesus was the exact opposite of what people lived by. Jesus would say things like, "The first shall be last," or "It's better to serve others than it is to be served," or "Love your enemies." And the people around him, like the Pharisees, would be like,
"What you talking about, Luke?"
These things confused the people who heard them, and they still confuse people even today. Jesus spent his life traveling from place to place, sharing his wisdom. One of the stories from the Bible about Jesus sharing wisdom is called the Sermon on the Mount. Let's listen to that story together.
God's story, the Sermon on the Mount. So part of God's story is about a sermon Jesus gave on the side of a mountain and what he did afterwards. And it goes like this. One day, when Jesus saw crowds gathering to hear him teach or see him do miracles, he went to the side of a mountain. It was near the Sea of Galilee, across from a place called Capernaum. From there, he gave a message all about God's kingdom and his love. We call this message the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus started by explaining who would get blessings or favor from God. He said the most blessed people are those who are poor, sad, or humble. He said God shows favor to people who are just or treat others fairly, and people who are merciful or show love to those who don't deserve it. He said the people who are pure, who bring peace, or who get hurt for doing right will be rewarded for their actions in heaven. In other words, the people who love others, even when it makes them seem weak or unimportant on earth, are like heroes in God's kingdom. Anyway, Jesus went on to explain that when we believe in and follow him, it's our job to show everyone else who he is by loving them. That means going out of our way not only to comfort and help our friends, but also forgive people who hurt us, love our enemies, and give to people in need. The thing is, Jesus didn't just talk about love, he showed it all the time. In fact, right after giving this sermon, Jesus spent the rest of the day helping everyone he met. Whenever somebody took their sickness or pain or fear to Jesus, he helped them. Everybody who met Jesus got to experience his love. And when we love like Jesus, everyone who meets us can feel his love too. And that's the story of the Sermon on the Mount. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version. Crowds gathered. Jesus went to a mountain. He gave a sermon. He talked about God's kingdom. He told us how to love others. Jesus didn't just talk about love. He showed it. He healed sick people. He saved people who were demon-possessed. He calmed storms. He showed his love to everyone he met. Our job is to do that too. And that's a part of God's story.
So that's the story of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus sharing his wisdom with us about a better way to live. I'm so thankful that Jesus came to earth to share his gospel. That's all I have for today. Have a good week, Jubilee.
Thank you, Paul Shelley. In the sermon today, or in the passage from James, it talks about two different kinds of wisdom. And we learned a little bit in our children's story about the wisdom that Jesus showed is the right kind of wisdom. And we want to encourage you to, as we listen to what Mike has to share with us this morning, to also be thinking about, as Christians, what is the wisdom that God has for us? James 3, 13 to 18. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. God, we ask your blessing on Mike as he shares what he has been studying and learning about wisdom. And we pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to receive what you have for us today. Amen.
Good morning, Jubilee. Times of deep distress call for deep wisdom. And I think we can assert with confidence this morning that we are living in times of deep distress. I'm not a historian like Paul Shelley is, but I believe the global COVID pandemic of 2020 and 2021 will long be remembered by historians and future generations. It has been a stressful 12 months since last March for all of our families. We are grieving the loss of friends and loved ones. Our mental and social health is suffering as we physically distance from each other. Our economy is suffering in ways that affect us all, but some much more than others. On top of this health and economic crisis, our country has also been experiencing a political crisis that has opened up deep fractures within our nation and our churches and even our families. Historic distress, we might call it. The stress of the past year has been putting a particular strain on folks in positions of leadership, political leaders, church leaders, business leaders, educational leaders, even household leaders. Just reflect for a minute on all the gut-wrenching decisions we have had to make over the past 12 months. As pastors and board members, as principals or teachers, as bosses and employees, as mothers and fathers, as sons and daughters. Whether to hold in-person services and other meetings, whether to travel to visit family, whether to go to work, whether to send our kids to school, how to care for those we love and those in need in ways that are safe and respectful, how to relate to those who see it all, and I mean everything, so differently than we do. And I could go on and on, but I trust you all can fill in the blanks. Over and over again, During the past year especially, we have had to pray for wisdom. And we have wisdom to call upon. We draw on cultural and folk wisdom to figure out how we do things and to figure out what works. We call that common sense. And we draw on financial wisdom to figure out how to secure and provide for ourselves and our families. We call that business sense. We draw on social and relational wisdom to figure out how to leverage our power and advance in life. We call that political sense. And this accumulated wisdom is often hard won and can be very useful in this world. But the question raised for us by the theme and the scriptures of today's sermon is whether all of our collective sense and sensibility, common, business, political, whether all of that qualifies as deep wisdom. Because, as I said at the beginning, times of deep distress call for deep wisdom. The lectionary guide for each Sunday's sermon always includes four scripture passages, and often the suggested theme for that Sunday is going to draw upon an idea from at least one of those scriptures. And this week, I find that each lectionary scripture speaks to our theme of deep wisdom in its own way. So please bear with me as I briefly look at all four. In Exodus 20, the Israelites were experiencing their own time of deep distress. Having recently escaped from the oppression of Pharaoh in Egypt, they were already grumbling and quarrelsome, fearful and prone to disobedience in their wilderness exile. It was in that context that the Lord gave Moses and his people the Ten Commandments, a behavioral and social code recorded there in Exodus 20 that has resonated across countless cultures and religions for several millennia since then. And even today, we display and memorize those Ten Commandments as a guide to wise and faithful living. In Psalm 19, the psalmist David praises the law of the Lord, the statutes, the commands, the precepts, the ordinances of the Lord, calling them more precious than gold and sweeter than honey. Now, we know from other psalms and other stories of David that he also was prone to fear and disobedience. David had, we might say today, a complicated relationship with the law of the Lord. He certainly walked through lonesome valleys of the shadow of death, in the presence of enemies, where he experienced despair and darkness and doubt, much like his Israelite forebears. But in Psalm 19, David proclaims that by the fear of the Lord is your servant warned. In keeping his precepts, there is great reward. And concludes with that wonderful supplication, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. A humble plea for deep wisdom. In John chapter 2, verses 13 through 22, Jesus himself becomes distressed and outraged when he arrives at the temple in Jerusalem to find merchants selling animals for sacrifice and money changers in the temple courtyard. This commercialization of the temple drives him to perhaps the strongest physical action of his ministry, overturning tables, scattering coins, using a whip to herd the animals out of the area. Again, one of the more remarkable depictions we have of a provoked, righteously passionate Jesus. And when the Jews question Jesus' authority and perhaps his wisdom for such disruptive behavior, he cryptically challenges them to destroy the temple, and he will raise it in 3 days. Not until later, after his resurrection, do his disciples realize that Jesus was referring to his own body and his own fulfillment of Scripture, his own revelation of the wisdom of God. And then finally, in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 to 25, the Apostle Paul, in fact, explicitly makes this very same point, referring to Jesus Christ as the power of God and the wisdom of God. But in this passage in Corinthians, Paul is drawing a sharp contrast between man's wisdom and God's wisdom. Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Paul asks, and then explains, Jews demand miraculous signs, and Greeks look for wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. Paul goes on to say, for the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. Paul's notion here is a deep one. His notion that the crucified Christ, publicly humiliated, bloodied, tortured, hung on a cross to die, represents the truest revelation of God's wisdom and the strongest confirmation of God's power. This idea is so upside down, so counterintuitive. It cuts against our accumulated cultural and folk wisdom. It makes no political sense, no business sense, no common sense. It is foolishness to all of our sensibilities. And yet I submit that it is the deepest, most profound notion in the entire New Testament, and that it continues to baffle the world and even the church today. In fact, as individuals and as a church, it is worth spending our entire lives plumbing the theological depths of Paul's idea here in 1 Corinthians. But this morning, I think our more immediate concern is the need for something concrete and applicable to today's challenges. We need practical handles for accessing this deep wisdom of God, because we are living through a time of such deep distress. And I believe the four scriptures from the lectionary guide, which we have looked at in progression, point us forward to yet another scripture, one of my very favorites, James 3, 13 to 18. As you heard Lisa read it this morning, this passage describes two kinds of wisdom. One type of wisdom is earthly, unspiritual, of the devil. It is founded on envy and selfish ambition, and it leads to disorder and every evil practice. On the other hand, The wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. This heavenly wisdom is evidenced by a good life and by deeds done in humility. Peacemakers who sow in peace, the passage concludes, raise a harvest of righteousness. What we have here in James 3 is really quite a clear and straightforward set of characteristics of deep wisdom. Times of deep uncertainty call for deep insight. And these are 8 criteria, if you will, that can help us discern whether the wisdom guiding us is from heaven or of the devil. Is it pure? Is it peace-loving? Is it considerate? Is it submissive? Is it full of mercy? Is it full of good fruit? Is it impartial? Is it sincere? What if we trained ourselves as individuals and as a church to always keep those questions in the front of our minds as we debate and discuss every decision, every response, every course of action? How would that change the way we address issues and engage problems or problematic people in our lives? How might our attention to these qualities of heavenly wisdom affect our approach to conflict and disagreements? Now, don't get me wrong. I am not suggesting that adhering to these 8 criteria will always make decisions easy or actions obvious. I mean, after all, times of easy and obvious solutions don't call for deep wisdom. Rather, it is precisely in times of difficult and challenging and stressful dilemmas that we need such handles to guide us. The problem, in my experience, is that it is at those times of deep distress that many of our sources of earthly wisdom compete most strenuously with this deep heavenly wisdom. Those are the times that the tapes of earthly wisdom start playing in our heads. You know the tapes that I'm talking about, right? I think you've heard them too. The tapes you hear may be different than mine, but the tapes, the good business sense tape that I hear goes something like this. Pure and sincere, that would be naive. Or the good political sense tape goes like submissive and merciful, that would be naive and weak. Or the good common sense tape might ask, good fruit for whom? Peace-loving and considerate? That would be naive and weak and foolish. No, I don't pretend that any of this is easy, but I humbly offer that our response to those questions and challenges raised by the mental tapes that we hear has to be that we are believers, we are Christ followers, and so we take to heart Paul's words in Corinthians that the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. And we heed James's warning that any wisdom that fails the heavenly wisdom test is unspiritual and of the devil. So is it pure? Is it peace-loving? Is it considerate? Is it submissive? Is it full of mercy? Is it full of good fruit? Is it impartial? Is it sincere? If not, James writes, it will ultimately lead to disorder and every evil practice. Just look around us, folks. We see that fruit everywhere. Recall, for example, the merchants and the money changers whom Jesus chased from the temple. Their activities may have made good business sense in the eyes of the world, yet were clearly unrighteous in the eyes of Jesus. So if our goal as Christians is to raise a harvest of righteousness, then perhaps what we need to do is to elevate James's heavenly wisdom test in our consciousness. Maybe we should print it out and display it prominently, like we do with the Ten Commandments. Perhaps we should memorize it and repeat it until it becomes the tape that plays in our head when we are faced with seemingly impossible decisions or discerning incredibly complicated courses of action. So when times of deep distress call for a response rooted in deep wisdom, may this be the tape that plays in our heads. The wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. Amen.
Purify my heart. May every word, every thought, every motive, every intention be pleasing in your sight, God. For your voice refreshes my soul, brings joy to my heart and light to my eyes. Your words more precious than gold, sweeter than honey, better than life. Purify my heart, may every word and every thought, every motive and every intention be pleasing in your sight, O God. For your voice refreshes my soul, brings joy to my heart and light to my eyes. Your words more precious than gold, sweeter than honey, better than life. Purify my heart, may every word, every thought, every motive, every intention be pleasing in your sight, O God. Be pleasing in your sight.
Jubilee, if you have responses to today's service, please email or text them to Kelsey today. With your permission, they will be included in tomorrow's newsletter so that all of Jubilee can hear from you and be blessed. Our announcements for this week. Monday is Walmart grocery delivery. Sunday is our church service on Zoom or in person at 10:45. Our theme will be called to deep healing, and it'll be the fourth Sunday of Lent, and our sermon will be by Dwayne Most. What is drawing you deeper toward God this Lent, Jubilee? To learn more about Lent, read page 1 of the Lent at Home guide that was mailed to Jubilee earlier. This week's scripture is noted on page 5. Jesus blesses the children, Matthew 19:13-15, and Mark 13-16. Jubilee, we are excited to announce the hope of returning to in-person worship next Sunday, March 14th. Between now and then, the elders and staff will continue to monitor the Mississippi weekly COVID rates, and we will return to worship in person with masks and space as we did in November. If you have any questions, please contact Dwayne or Elaine. Mark your calendars for the Jubilee Campout at Pine Lake on April 9 to 11. Come out to Pine Lake to visit with your Jubilee friends. This year, there will be less programming and more time to just enjoy a relaxing weekend at beautiful Pine Lake Camp. For lodging reservations, contact Cheryl Landis. Questions? Talk to Dwayne or Elaine Most. Are you looking for a way to stay connected with Jubilee? Make sure to check your email tomorrow for Jubilee's newsletter. And if you have any prayer requests to add to the newsletter, please text them to Kelsey today. If you're worshiping through Zoom, remember that after the benediction, you are welcome to turn on your audio and video and visit with each other. Let's pause to pray to bring our worship service to a close. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Go in peace, Jubilee, to serve God this week and think on God's wisdom. Amen.